My name is Maike Schabowski. After humanistic studies, I somehow by chance ended up in IT. About 23 years ago, 17 of them, I am working for SUSE Linux, which is a Linux and open source infrastructure provider. And the bigger part, roughly 16 years, I was on the other side in marketing, product marketeer. And for a bit more than a year now, I am working in the team as a documentation strategist. I already heard, huh? Funny, documentation strategist. Well, it's quite easy. It has a lot to do with the topic, with the main theme of the conference here. It's more solution finding, problem solving. Just as an example, I'm trying to find and test new channels for documentation to keep our readers and customers engaged with us. We also realized that our documentation is very much product focused, and we needed to have some more solution providing documentation. So we created a new series called SUSE Best Practices. Another point is standardization. Documentation team in engineering is not the only team that provides kind of tech documents. There are also teams outside of engineering in alliances or so, and they are also providing tech documents, but they have a different look and feel, and it doesn't work really well because everybody outside, the customers, they think, hey, that's tech documentation that must come from the tech documentation team. So we want to standardize our documents, and that's also part of my work. So I brought my team with me. You see a lot of humanists, journalists, physicians, chemists, and I think one or two real technical writers. So the main focus of our work is maintaining our product documentation, writing it, of course, first, and then maintaining it. We provide currently about 12 to 15,000 pages of documentation. But this is not only the only task the team has. We are also doing software translation management. We are writing articles for technical issues, for technical magazines. We are helping developers. We are mentoring them to write articles and many, many, many other tasks. Why I'm standing here now? Of course, like all other companies that are not doing open source, we want to deliver best documentation possible to our customers. And we also want our developers and technicians to document what they are doing. So, who of you is working in an open source environment? Wow! More than I thought. Am I the only alien here? Okay, so I can tell you, living in an open source world is great. Being a documentarian in an open source world comes with quite some challenge. First, there's a bunch of tools outside for documentation, but they are mostly proprietary, commercial, not open source, or they are even not available for Linux. So we have to deal with that. You can imagine that in an open source world, using commercial or proprietary tools can become somewhat religious quite soon. And you don't want to have that. So we try to use open source tools where available. And by the way, we are also providing all our documentation under an open license, like the GNU Free Documentation License or Creative Commons. So that's the first challenge. The second challenge, Linux is developed by a community of volunteers. Well, some of them are paid also. However, you can hardly force them to work on documentation. So they love developing, but not necessarily writing. So these are the main challenges we have to deal with. And my team overcomes those challenges within the workflow. It might seem quite complex at first sight, but let's go into some of the components of the workflow here. First, you get a request for documentation. We have different channels how we get requests or requirements. One is the so-called FATE tool. It's the feature and requirement management tool. It's developed in-house because we didn't find a tool that would fulfill our needs. This tool is used by the entire engineering department. And there's an extra column for documentation. If you look there, wonderful. What documentation has to be changed, should changes, and so on and so forth. A lot of text to fill in, normally. We also use Bugzilla, the bug tracking tool, which is open source, for requests, new requirements, and enhancements of the documentation. There's a third tool, which you don't find on the slide here. It's called Doc Comments. It is developed in-house, where you can put online comments to our HTML versions, which are sent to us by email. Of course, you can also send a normal email. We take everything. Okay. So next step in the workflow is to evaluate, accept, and organize all those requirements. For the entire management of the requirements, we use Trello, the web-based tool where you can collaborate on boards. Yes, I know Trello is not open source, but it operates on a freemium business model, so you can use the basic services for free here. By the way, we had to ask for allowance from our Workers' Council to use it. So, as I said, we manage the entire requests via Trello. We do the schedules, we write down who are the experts we have to talk with, we prioritize the tasks, and so on and so forth. It's a great tool for collaboration. You can invite groups, whatever. And it is also, in the meantime, used by the entire development team. The requirements are decided by a team, a broader team, so the original requester is invited to discuss if a feature needs to be done. Of course, the project and the product manager of the respective product and the documentation project manager and the expert. So they decide as a team quite quickly, also via email, if to do documentation for a certain feature or not. So, next step is, where does all the content come from? Well, coming from an alien in marketing to the documentation team, I always thought, well, it's easy. Documentation gets all the content from the developers, and they just have to translate it in understandable words for the users. That would be the ideal world. Reality is different and made my hair stand on end. Like the dog's hair here. So, development has tight schedules. Developers love to write code, but not necessarily text. Well, I found one, Rafael, one developer who likes to do documentation. Woohoo! So, the other thing is, and Dagmar talked about that, you have to have in mind that most documentation for product needs to go to translation way before the product will be released. Open source developers tend to develop until the last day. Last minute, yes. So we have to deliver our documentation roughly 8 to 12 weeks before the product will be released. So, well, you have to deal with the situation. My team really is getting expert. We have so many talented people there. They started to set up semi-final products or even only quarterly final products. They installed the products, they went through every single step, they documented what they found, they are also a quality assurance team because they find bugs, they report it back to the developers and so on and so forth. So they made a virtue out of necessity and they are really now experts in working with semi-final products. Well, that's how they create the content. We are writing in DocBook XML. This is a semantic markup language for technical documentation. As one of you mentioned it before, was it Jarek? I think so. It's based on the extensible markup language. It defines the content in a semantic way similar to HTML. It's an open standard tool, and it is used by many, many open source projects. DocBook XML is written as a schema which fulfills two tasks mainly. This is guided editing and validation. I had to learn DocBook XML from scratch and I really like it. It's the best thing for our purposes. I heard many of you are using Dita. We use DocBook because we have a lot of large documentation files and we need profiling because sometimes it happens quite often that we need to take the text of a file and via profiling we make it available for another product because many of the content is similar. So yeah, of course DocBook XML doesn't come with an editor, so we are free to use whatever editor we want, be it command line or a graphic tool. So some of you might recall the editor war, which is still active, at least in my company. So the Goya painting here, I was made aware by a colleague, the classic programmer paintings, Emacs versus Vim. We can use Emacs, we can use Vim, we can use JEdit, Sublime Text, Oxygen, whatever comes to your mind, you name it. Probably also one day XEditor. We had a workshop yesterday about it. And via the editor, we also have the guided writing. Style guide. I think that word was mentioned several times today. Yes, also in SUSE, we have defined our own style guide. This is, of course, to make sure that we provide consistent content to our customers. We define the style and tone. We talked about that also already today. Our style is not passive. We directly address the reader. We have a terminology. There are words that we are not allowed to use. We define the elements in the style guide. Yesterday I learned that Dita has more than 528 elements or text that you can use. I have no clue how many there are in DocBook XML, however, way too much. So we stripped that down to a usable list of elements we work with. And all these things are defined in the style guide. Our style guide is also publicly available. You can have a look at it if you just Google it. While we are writing, we are at the same time setting up our infrastructure. We are using Git, which is our main version control system, and it's also great for collaboration. GitHub is where we host our sources. They are publicly available. Again, everybody can contribute. Everybody can do a pull request, be it a customer, be it a developer from outside our company. So it's open source. Everybody can contribute here. GitFlow is a collection of scripts that make the daily work with Git easier. We use GitLab, which provides closed or proprietary repositories just and only for some internal document, like something that we cannot really officially yet share. Sometimes we have documents under non-disclosure with partners or so, then we have to use GitLab here. Next tool is called DAPS. It's the DocBook Authoring and Publishing Suite. This tool is really great. It's a single command line tool, which is available for all Linux platforms. There is different Linux outside, like SUSE Linux or Red Hat or Ubuntu. So you can work with DAPS on all those Linux platforms. It is the tool with which we transform our XML sources into the output formats. And we can provide HTML, single HTML, EPUB, PDF, main page, normal plain text, and some others. So the thing is, we didn't find a tool that could do all that for us. So my colleague, Frank Sundermeier, one of the guys on the third slide, just thought by himself, well, I invent such a tool. And so he did, and it's open sourced and available for everybody. That's the life in an open source company. DAPS does many good things. It supports DocBook style sheets, but also customized style sheets. It does spell checking for us, link checking, validation. It looks really, I said it before in our style guide, we limited the elements to a certain range. If we use elements that are outside that style guide range, DAPS shouts at us and says, no, not validated, do it again, search for your error here. So DAPS is really a great tool, and as said, publicly available. So if one day you switch to Linux, have a look at it. I mentioned the style sheets before, SLT style sheets. They define our layout for the different types of documentation. We do have bigger books. You see an example here. The deployment guide, it is a book with a subset of smaller books, and it contains about 400 pages all in all. Then in the middle you see the style, the output style of an article. We use article for quick starts and for the SUSE best practices, which I mentioned before. And then you see also an HTML output from a SUSE best practices paper. The XSLT style sheets are also written by my colleagues in documentation, Thomas Schreitle and Stefan Knorr. They were also on that picture, so that's the reason why I brought them, because they are really doing a lot of stuff in addition. So, while we are still writing, we are starting to build our documents in the different output formats. We look after validation for the correct links, the references, the spelling. This is all done via DAPS. We build in PDF, in HTML, whatever. We have a look if the output is correct. Of course, after we build the documents, we have a peer review, technical review, everything you need, quality assurance. So, and then when we think we are close to a first final version of a document, we restart the entire building process, and the loop is turning and turning. So we repeat the steps, we build the documents in the different output formats, and we have, again, expert review, because I told you before, the product is still under development, things could have changed already, so it's a loop. And then when we think we are close to a final version of the document, well, we perform, again, QA with a tool called Style Checker. Style Checker is built in-house by my colleague Stefan Knorr, because we couldn't find anything that would fulfill our needs. The Style Checker checks if we are following our own guidelines set up by the style guide. It has different sections. For example, we are not allowed at all to use abbreviations. FE, for example, doesn't work. It shouts at you. Yeah? If you use the wrong element, it shouts and cries and whatever. So then we talked about before we talked about being precise, concise, and short in documentation. Yes, Style Checker also tells us, hey, your sentence has 28 words. That's way too much. Cut it down. Yeah. Figures, if there's anything missing, a title to a figure, or sometimes we should add text to a figure, it gives us a warning. Yeah, you see different colors here. There are the red exclamation marks and the yellow question marks. So sometimes it really shouts, and sometimes it just warns and says, are you sure you want to do that? So you have some chance to decide yourself. Well, and then we come to the topic that Dagmar talked about. Of course, we do translation. Not everything will be translated, but most of the documents. We write originally in English, and we have 3 to 7 languages we translate to. And again, there's a tool that has been developed in-house. It's called Doc Manager. And my colleague Frank Sundermeyer, who also invented the DAPS tool, created it. Doc Manager brings a lot of metadata information. And the main or the most important feature it has is really telling us about the translation. It tags the document that needs to be translated, and it tells us in which language it has to be translated. Translation itself happens via language service provider, a tech specialist in Ireland. So here we have, again, proofreading for free in English. Yeah, so that's how the entire workflow goes. So what a few slides ago probably seemed to be very complex, hopefully is much more clear now. If you are living in an open source world as a documentarian, you have to deal with challenges. I'm not sure if it came through, but somehow my team managed and still manages to get over those challenges every day, being it by developing tools we need by ourselves. And it worked out quite well so far. The good thing is really that people is approaching us now. They are coming to us and telling us, well, we want to standardize to your workflow, to your tools in documentation, because we see it makes sense. It gives us a common look and feel to our customers outside. I said it before, there are different departments that are outside of development doing technical documents. Currently, or for now, they are still publishing via marketing, and that's completely different. They are working a lot with PDFs. And so this is one thing that is really great to see. Another thing is that guys from the outer space, from the outer world, are using DAPS. There are companies approaching us, asking us, hey, we have tried and checked out your DAPS tool, and we would like to use it often. Can you give us some training or so? So these things are really working very well for us, and I'm proud, I think I can say it because I'm not a real writer in the team. I'm writing some stuff, but not like the others, not the real heavy product documentation. But I'm really proud of the team that it is able to do those work every day and has found its way to get over the challenges. So, yeah, I think that was it. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you a lot. Guys, questions about open source documentation? We've got one here.
That's the hardest part.
maybe not a question, a remark. Amazing coincidence, because as I mentioned, we also use DocBook at the beginning, And we also were, we also created our own tools for publishing, because originally we were publishing manually from Oxygen, and then saving files in NVSS. And we created our own tool for publishing, and we called it DAPE, which was...
That's cool. Do you have a link for it or something?
No. It's probably nobody. This is one more thing I wanted to mention. Like, it was called DocBook Automated Publishing Environment. The thing is that I think that such tool building, to the extent that you do, is only possible in the in the open source world, because if an author, if a developer who created the code is gone, the way it is performed makes possible for other people to catch up and continue that. In a corporation like mine, it's impossible. Like, if I'm gone, nobody's going to understand it.
And that's the reason why we open source everything, so everybody can have a look into the code. And there's not only Frank who is developing dApps, there's now other people that works on the same project, so we are sure that the knowledge is not lost if he would be gone or so. And yes, you might have realized the development of the tools really came out of the pain for not finding tools that fit. Yeah. I said it before, in an open source world, you have difficulties to find certain tools, and then you have to do something yourself. And that is what I wanted to show here. There are solutions for every problem, even if you are limited, or if you think you are limited.
Yeah, and it's just code. You can code anything.
Yes, exactly.
Just, you only need time.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Anyone else? Okay.
And more questions? Rafael, don't forget about it. I want to do a picture with you, because I have to show the world a developer who loves documenting. Yeah.
It's not so unique, you know. I have a question, because I'm not sure if I understand correctly the whole workflow of documentation. When the doc request is in, does it contain any proposal for the documentation?
Yes, it should.
Okay, it should.
It should. So it should, when the doc request, let's say a feature request comes in, and the original feature requester should provide already a bunch of information for documentation. So what needs to be first thing, is there anything that needs to be documented for this feature? Because sometimes you don't need to document it really, because it's important only for internal stuff or so. If it needs to be documented, is there already available public information? We are talking about Linux here, so it could be that there's already a man page or a project page or whatever. So please fill in the link to that project. If you are, if you have a better idea of the use case, fill in the use case. Yeah. So, the hope is really that we get as much information via the FADE tool as possible, but we all know that reality looks different.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we had one more question. Oh, two more, but two different ones.
Hello. Hey. When can we expect in-house custom developed version of Trello, which is open source?
Well, I wouldn't say a date here, but I would expect that somebody's already developing on it. I'm sure there are alternatives already. So, but as far as I know, because we had that discussion too, but they do not fulfill all the functionality of Trello yet. I'm sure the time will be coming.
Okay, and one more here in front, right here.
I'm very interested in a style checker.
Okay.
Can you tell me more about what can it check? For example, if in your style guide you require technical writers to use avoid using passive voices, can it also check to that extent?
No.
Because my company has a very comprehensive style guide, which we normally teach technical writers and train them so that they can just keep it in mind. But we're human, we're imperfect.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any way to automate that?
Currently, the style checker cannot check the passive voice. I'm sure it would be possible to bring it in. This is something we still have to check manually with our own eyes, but it really can check. So, well, you know, Style Checker had been developed as a bachelor thesis from one of our guys who is now working for SUSE as a full-time employee. But I'll take that with me and will ask him if it would be possible to insert it or include it into the tool. Currently, it really does a lot of things. It checks the length of a sentence. It checks the entire terminology that we defined. I think I mentioned many, many things, and we can go in detail. I can show you the style checker also. But passive voice and tone, so far we did not yet include. Yeah, but it's a good idea.
One more? Okay, let's make it the last one.
Oh, I just wanted to say there is a tool, open source tool called LangTool, and it's I think it's developed by the community around LibreOffice and OpenOffice, and it also can check stylistics, grammar, and stuff like that. And you can also write your own rules, so probably you can check for the passive voice.
Yeah, there are many, many open source tools that do these things, but doing exactly what we needed with also checking elements, text, titles, and so on, we couldn't find any tool that would fulfill all those requirements. Yeah, and that's also, you know, somehow the bad thing with open source. It's really great, but you have a lot of choice at the end.
Okay, Meike, thank you a lot for your talk. Big applause, please.